is this couple, and I want you to give them a wonderful welcome, Kevin and Danielle Odell. They come from Woodbridge, Virginia. They're high school sweethearts. I was talking to them backstage. They have been married 3 years. They love each other. They dated 7 years. I'm going, what? Are you a little too conservative here? What? Moving on along. They planted roots in the north of Virginia. They stay active in family and church. They're local business owners, and they are inspired by Dr. Ron Paul's Freedom First perspective. So put your hands together for Kevin and Danielle. They're going to introduce the man.
Thank you. I'd like to just get all the Ron Paul supporters fired up for all right. I need you guys out there just to stand up for liberty, rise up against tyranny. That's right. That's right. That's right. We do need to end the Fed. Thank you very much, guys. When Danielle and I were given the opportunity to come to CPAC and introduce Congressman Ron Paul, we were speechless. This is a man who's been extremely influential on our lives, as well as gotten us excited and passionate about the true conservative movement. Not the fake one. He served our country as a flight surgeon. He's a medical doctor, an OBGYN, who's delivered over 4,000 babies. And it really is no surprise that his message has created so much enthusiasm with young Americans. We feel that that's really important because we really are the future. Rather than following the mainstream Republican message, we need to embrace a message of freedom, liberty, and independence through limited government. The thing that's great about Ron Paul and why I look up to him is because he's always positive and humble, and he's always had the courage to consistently force real issues of non-interventionist foreign policy, and monetary fiscal conservatism, instead of latching on to the continued rhetoric we hear from other politicians and so-called conservatives.
Because Ron Paul's message is simple yet strong. It's a message built on solid principles of our founding fathers of this great country. We need to get as passionate about our country and our sovereignty as we do about football games and the next American Idol. We've come a long way since the 2008 campaign. Just a few years ago, most people had no idea that the Federal Reserve was a private and independent agency looting the American taxpayer. In addition to their awareness, Ron Paul's Audit the Fed Bill, H.R. 1207, has gained 317 co-sponsors and has passed the House.
That's right. It's passed the House in the Senate.
So we're excited to say that people are waking up. People are getting excited about the movement. Just look here at what the Campaign for Liberty, the impact they've had on this event alone. So now without further ado, it is our pleasure and our honor to introduce to you presidential candidate,
Texas Congressman,
Dr. Ron Paul.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Wow, thank you. Thank you, thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. It sounds to me like the revolution is alive and well. Wonderful. It's great to see such a nice crowd. Quite a few here. 10,000 people, all interested in promoting good government, limited government, and personal liberty. I would say this is a grand opportunity for all of us to come together because something is brewing. Something is brewing big. This is a different year than anything we have ever experienced before, and I am optimistic to believe that a lot of good is going to come out of what is happening in this country today, whether it's the CPAC meeting or the Tea Party movements or the recent victories in the elections. But believe me, by the end of this year, I think this country is going to be a lot better off. You know, the one thing I think brings so many of us together and what's been happening these last couple years has been the idea of having change. As a matter of fact, somebody won an election with using that slogan, a change. But there's a change that we want that we haven't gotten yet. And I think that's what we're here to talk about. What kind of change do we really want? And what can we agree on so that we're not talking about different things? And to me, it's very important that we understand what conservatism means. To me, to be a conservative means to conserve the good parts of America and to conserve our Constitution. I first got involved in politics in the 1970s because I was very concerned about the financial situation. The Bretton Woods Agreement broke down. The gold standard was cast aside. And I said, this will usher in the age of big government. And that came in under a Nixon administration. And since that time, we have been struggling. We have been struggling with a conservative message. And we have had bits and pieces of this coming together, but we really haven't had to follow through. We had a revolution of sorts in 1980 with Ronald Reagan. And then of course, we had 1994, and we took over the Congress. And that, of course, was very good, and that was designed to limit government. But government kept growing. Also, in the year 2000, we had a remarkable event, something that hadn't happened in more than 40 years. It was probably 50 years, where there was a Republican president, a Republican Congress, a House, and a Republican Senate. But we didn't get the revolution. There was a lot of desire and a lot of pressure by people like you and saying, what we want is limited government. We want balanced budgets. We want our liberties back. You know, and I think what has happened, and I see what our problems are in philosophic terms, not in partisan terms. And I think what happened, especially back in the teens of the last century when Woodrow Wilson was president, that, and those boos are rightly deserved, let me tell you. But I also use this as an opportunity to put a little pressure on conservatives who had some of their views changed that time. Just think of what Woodrow Wilson stood for. He stood for world government. He wanted a early, you know, United Nations, League of Nations. But it was the conservatives, Republicans, that stood up against it. But how often have you heard today, maybe you did, but how many people are saying it's the conservative position to not even belong to the United Nations? In 1913 wasn't a very good year. 1913 gave us the income tax, the 16th Amendment, and the IRS. And what's wrong with getting rid of the income tax and the 16th Amendment? I think it'd be a great idea. And of course, I've already taken a very modest position on the monetary system. I do take the position that we should just end the Fed. But there were other things that went on during the Wilson's administration. Our foreign policy changed. I think it was for the negative. His goal was to make the world safe for democracy, and he prodded us into a war that we should have never gotten into. And we, as conservatives, too many conservatives, have accepted this principle that it is our moral and legal constitutional responsibility to engage ourselves and make the world safe for democracy. I don't think it's possible. Matter of fact, if you think back just a short time ago to the year 2000, when George Bush was running, guess what he ran on? And guess what he won on? He was running against an interventionist foreign policy. He was running against Clinton's policy of intervention, nation building, and the policemen of the world. And he was elected on that. There's nothing wrong with being a conservative and come up with a conservative belief in foreign policy where we have a strong national defense and we don't go to war so carelessly. Is not conservative about saying, don't go to war unless we go to war properly with a full declaration of war and no other way. Unconstitutional wars cost a lot of money. They undermine our constitutional principles. And as Randolph Bourne said, war is the health of the state. So if you like small government, you need to work hard at having a strong national defense that is not so militant. Personal liberty is the purpose of government, to protect liberty, not to run your personal lives, not to run the economy, and not to pretend that we can tell the world how they ought to live. Now, for those who disagree, I have a few comments, because I understand the disagreement. I've been there, and I've been in the service, and I've spent 5 years in the service, and I know all the argument. But the bottom line, eventually, for all conservatives and all constitutionalists will be, how are we going to pay for it? It's driving us to the bankruptcy. We are now spending $1 trillion a year to manage our world empire. We're in 140 countries. We have 700 bases. And quite frankly, have you noticed the debt is exploding? And it's not all because of Medicare. And believe me, we don't have enough conservatives on the Hill to start tinkering with Medicare. They're not going to cut that. So eventually, this country probably won't do what I suggest, that we back off and back down, spend only the money that's constitutional. I've made two promises in my district. I will always vote what I have promised. I will and always vote the Constitution, as well as I will not vote for one single penny that isn't paid for, because debt is the monster. Debt is what's going to eat us up, and that is why our economy is on the brink. We haven't had the collapse, and we haven't had the correction. We are on the brink of a financial cataclysmic event. Because what we're leading to, because we're spending too much money, we borrow too much. And at the present time, the Chinese have backed off on what they're loaning us. Interest rates are starting to go up. Inflation factors are coming up. Believe me, the next step is a currency crisis, because there will be a rejection of the dollar. The rejection of the dollar is a big, big event. And then your personal liberties are going to be severely threatened, because then we'll usher in people who say, well, just like they have so far. We've had an event. And this is not the Democrats alone. Democrats and Republicans, they said, oh, there's an event. So what we should do is spend more money, stimulate the economy, borrow more money. And still there wouldn't be enough. So what did we do? We go to the Fed and we tell the Fed, print more money. Believe me, it won't last. It's going to end. You can't double the money supply. You can't double the money supply and not expect some really big events within inflation. But back again to Woodrow Wilson. He was not an individual who respected civil liberties. And the conservative Republicans at the time fought him on the Espionage and Sedition Act. The Republicans didn't like it. He arrested thousands of people because they showed dissent against the war. Yes, how do you want it? You want it that way? Yes, you may have a position on the war. Others may have another position. But we all ought to be together that you have a right of dissent and you should never be put in prison for dissenting. Famous person was arrested back then. I wouldn't have agreed with his political beliefs, but he was a famous person, but he did speak out against the war, which he had a right to do, and that was Eugene Debs. And he was put in prison because he spoke out, and Woodrow Wilson didn't like him, and because the Congress passed these laws, which the Republicans objected to. But he was put in prison indefinitely, and I guess because of Woodrow Wilson's illness and all, toward the end, he never got a pardon. Do you know who gave him the pardon? Warren G. Harding, a Republican. There is nothing wrong with describing conservatism as protecting the Constitution, protecting all things that limit government. Government is the enemy of liberty. Government should be very restrained. And as I have said so many times, it's time that we do study and understand from a conservative viewpoint on how much we should be engaged around the world. And we have good backing from good Republicans of the past. But now, that is the past. I don't live in the past because I see freedom as a very progressive modern movement. But in the past, since Woodrow Wilson's time, we as conservatives, too many, have taken on this saying that we are responsible, but that is a neoconservative viewpoint and not true conservatism. Who do you think it was that tried to keep us out of the wars? The Republicans did. One of the greatest Republicans, and he's called Mr. Republican. There's a statue over in Washington, and that is Robert Taft. He worked hard to keep us out of war. He also thought that it was a violation of our rights to have a military draft. He strongly opposed the draft. He was strongly opposed to NATO and didn't like the United Nations, and here we have, casually accepted all this. But who was it that coined the word the military-industrial complex and beware of it? It was Eisenhower that told us about that. So there's every reason for us to think seriously about, what we really believe in and what conservatism actually really means. You know, in 1956, I was in college, but I thought a draft was coming because the French and the British, got into a fight over the Suez Canal with the Egyptians. The Egyptians wanted their canal, running the canal. So I was worried because I thought I'd be drafted. I wasn't drafted for 10 years after that, but I thought I'd be drafted because they came to Eisenhower and they said, come help us, take care of us. They're taking this canal. And Eisenhower says, I'll have no part of it. But back 100 years ago, especially around Woodrow Wilson, what happened in this country is we took freedom and we chopped it into pieces. We don't think of freedom as something unified. There is only one kind of freedom, and that's individual liberty. Our lives come from our Creator, and our liberty comes from our Creator. It has nothing to do with government granting it. If you want small government to protect liberty, that is well and good, and that's what the founders believed. And that is exactly what the Constitution was written for. But if we have some group over here defending, oh, economic liberty is good, that's right, we do, except a Republican president said, we're all Keynesians now, and we've been living with the Keynesian philosophy and economics. They're still all over the Hill. And how many people on the Hill are saying, and the Fed? But personal liberty, if our liberties come to us as individuals, they are not collective. They do not. Freedom does not come in groups. You don't have freedom because you're a hyphenated American. You have freedom because you're an individual, and that should be protected. But I do not believe freedom can survive, and I do not believe we as conservatives can contribute much if we still think freedom only comes in pieces, that you can protect economic liberty but not personal liberty. Sure, I imagine everybody in this crowd would say, yes, protect our right of free speech, protect our right to our religious values. But as soon as it comes to putting something in your mouth or in your lungs, you say, you don't have enough sense to decide what you should do, so we are going to use the heavy hand of government to come down and protect you against yourself. But we have gone a long way from the dictates of the Constitution. The Constitution, of course, says that only under declaration of war can we go to war. But we're in perpetual war now in every country in the world. It's going to last a long time until we go bankrupt. That is what I believe is happening. But we have done a few other things that aren't conservative, as far as I'm concerned, endorsed by both political parties. And one is that we have now endorsed the principle of preventive war. Another term for preventive war is aggressive war, starting wars because someday somebody might do something to us. That is not part of the American tradition. Just last week, there was a hearing on the Hill. The subject of assassinations came up. And the administration was there, and they explained that, yes, they indeed do endorse the idea of assassination. And then they were asked, would you endorse the idea that we have the obligation to assassinate American citizens? And the answer is yes, they do. They claim that they have the right to assassinate American citizens. Now, what are the conditions? Somebody in the administration, we don't know exactly who, makes a determination that that individual is a threat. And if he's a threat, then he can be assassinated. Now you say, well, he's probably a bad guy, and he probably is, the people they pick. They only have three. But the principle is important. Someday there might be six or eight or ten. What if that would have been the fact that Eugene's Debs might have not have been put in prison? He might have been assassinated because he was a threat. So this is not just casual talk. This is not radical left-wing liberalism protecting civil liberties. This is protecting the whole integrity of our country and our Constitution and the rights of the individual. We now have, as a country, have accepted the principle that habeas corpus is only worthwhile in a limited fashion. Some people don't deserve it. If they're designed as a threat, they can be held for unlimited time in detentions. It can be secret detention and still susceptible to torture. That is not what we're all about. We're much better than that. And we as conservatives have to realize that we have to bring this back together again. Good conservatives can believe that personal liberty is of the utmost value. We all probably more easily agree the free market is a good way to go, and yet we still have a lot of people who have to reject the notion of regulations and benefits and bailout for Wall Street and the Federal Reserve System and paper money. All these things have to be worked in. But there is nothing wrong with you being a conservative in saying the Republican conservative tradition, not too long ago, as recent as year 2000, we won elections by saying we shouldn't be the policemen of the world and that we shouldn't be nation building. And it's time we got those values back into this country. I believe we're on the verge of something very significant. I've spoken out quite a few times on college campuses in the last couple of years, and the reception is fantastic. And they want the whole package. They don't want bits and pieces. They want their personal liberty. They want their economic liberty, and they don't want dependency on the government because the government has failed, and they know they're not going to get their Social Security, and they don't want perpetual war. They'll defend this country. I have more support from the military than any other one candidate during the campaign. So let us take this opportunity. Let us take this opportunity, and though for those of you who disagree, all I ask you to do is think seriously about it. Think about it and read about it and study it and put it in context and say, maybe that has a point. You know, during the campaign, the presidential campaign, you know, off in the corner, laugh at him, all this stuff. Then all of a sudden, the crash that I was predicting and talking about and said we were on the verge of and we were beginning, it came. And then all of a sudden now, Fox News Networks had me on their TV about 60 times since the campaign was over. But let me finish by saying that one reason why I really like this idea of bringing freedom together and why freedom works is I really think it brings people together. I do like different people to come together because freedom doesn't challenge people's personal values. They don't challenge their religious values. They only say, come together on your terms as long as you don't mess around with me. There are two rules that I have. One is that I want change, and I want a lot of changes, but I preach nonviolent change. I want resistance to the current system. But the other thing that I have to keep reminding myself, and I'll remind others, that in the process of us pursuing our goals, that we should remain tolerant. People who disagree with you or look different or have different views, we have to allow freedom of expression. That will bring us together. Otherwise, we can't win. So I thank you very much for this opportunity to visit with you. I hope it is challenging because we're in challenging time. But quite frankly, if we do the right things, we can pull out of the economic mess we have and we can be better than ever. And I believe that's what this type of an organization and group of people coming together, because I know you want what is best for America. And if we work together and are a bit more tolerant, I believe we can achieve it. Thank you very much.
Waving your banner all over the place.
We will rock you.
Sing it out.
We will rock you.
Buddy, you're an old man, poor man, pleading with your eyes, gonna make you zombie someday. You got mud on your face, big disgrace, somebody better.